essential original teachings of Christianity, especially in regard to salvation, how people can be forgiven of sin through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ and receive eternal life with God. The Reformation sought to reorient Christianity on the original message of Jesus and the early church. The five solas are five Latin phrases or slogans that emerged during the Reformation to summarize the Reformers' theological convictions about the essentials of Christianity. As we listen to tonight's offering of songs, let us remember that Martin Luther's Reformation also introduced congregational singing into the worship service. Martin Luther once said, "Next to theology, I accord the highest place to music."
Solus Christus, by Christ alone. All scripture is about Christ. All saving faith is in Christ. All grace flows from Christ. All glory belongs to Christ. Solus Christus, by Christ alone. Is it any surprise that Solus Christus stands at the very center of the solas? Indeed, it is the backbone. When the vast and complicated religious system Rome had constructed over the centuries, a system so corrupt that even the finished work of Christ himself was contingent upon the acts of man, when Rome, not Christ, had become the great vending machine of God's grace, when the system proclaimed that grace was mediated by layers of church officials and sacramental works, Solus Christus became the Reformers' rally cry. The Reformation said no. Christ alone dispenses the grace of God, not the church. Christ alone is the mediator between God and man, not any priest. Christ is unique and exclusive, and Christ's work is all sufficient. We must look to Christ alone for divine favor. Our FEC statement of faith states, "We believe that Jesus Christ is true God and true man, the Savior of mankind, and the only mediator between God and man. Having been conceived of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, he died on the cross, a sacrifice for our sins, according to the scriptures. Further, he rose bodily from the dead, ascended into heaven, where at the right hand of the Majesty on high, he is now our High Priest and Advocate."
Scripture alone. The Bible alone is our highest authority. There are a number of things that we could say about this topic of Martin Luther and Scripture, but let's look at just a few. The first is the authority of Scripture. We see this in Luther at the Leipzig debate in 1519. One of the monuments to Luther in Aix-les-Bains has an etching on the side of a very angry-looking Roman Catholic official. That angry-looking official is Johann Eck. On the other side of Eck is Luther, and Eck is holding in his hand some bound-up documents, while Luther is holding a book, the Bible, and that tells it all. Eck, at Leipzig, appealed to the teachings of the councils, the teachings of the church, and those rolled-up documents represent that. He came at Luther and the Wittenberg reformers from the context of the church and the church's authority. And Luther said to Eck, "I have an authority that is older than yours." And of course, this astounded Eck, and he said, "Name them." Luther said, "Paul and Peter and John." Luther appealed directly to the authority of Scripture at Leipzig, and of course, he did the same thing at Worms. So, at Worms, he said, "My conscience is captive to the word of God." When he said, "Here I stand," he was standing on Scripture and standing firm on the foundation of Scripture. And because Scripture is authoritative, we should read it and we should study it. Sola Scriptura also means that everything necessary, everything binding on our consciences, and everything God requires of us is given to us in Scripture. Hebrews 4:12 says, "For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. The first statement in FEC's Statement of Faith declares, we believe the scriptures, both Old and New Testaments, to be the Word of God, inspired by the Holy Spirit, the complete revelation of His will for the salvation of men, and the divine and final authority for all Christian faith and life.
The choir will sing, Here I Stand, Mine is the Mighty Fortress is Our God, which is the most famous of Martin Luther's 38 hymns. The title and first line conjure up the image of a castle, a stronghold, not unlike Wartburg Castle, as it towers over the town of Oslo, where Luther stayed after the deed of Worms. Looking at the Wartburg, you get a sense of security. Luther wants us to think of God as our mighty fortress, as a bulwark who never fails us. Faith is only as good as its object. When the one that you believe is crucified and the risen one, Jesus Christ our Lord, the very Son of God, enthroned at the right hand of the Father, then your faith will be born. Luther's discovery of the gospel, as it's been called, came during his scholarly labors as a doctor in Biblia. The pivotal text was Romans 1:17. Luther said, "At last, as I meditated day and night on the relation of the words, the righteousness of God is revealed in it, as it is written, the righteous person shall live by faith." I began to understand that righteousness of God as that by which the righteous person lives by the gift of God. And this sentence, the righteousness of God is revealed, to refer to a passive righteousness by which the merciful God justifies us by faith, as it is written, the righteous person lives by faith. This immediately made me feel as though I was born again, and as though I had entered through open gates into paradise itself. From that moment, I saw the whole face of Scripture in a new light. And now, where I had once hated the phrase, righteousness of God, I began to love and extol it as the sweetest of phrases, so that this passage in Paul became the very gate of paradise to me. Luther considered justification by faith the summary of all Christian doctrine and the article by which the church stands or falls. Therefore, sola fide is the first commandment issue, as Luther clearly saw. Sola fide is the battle cry of the Reformation, because it puts all things in their proper order. Good works follow, but they never precede. Believers are exhorted to good works, but not for salvation. Sola fide is created by the proclamation of sola scriptura, and its object is sola Christus. And this is only because of sola gratia. Sola fide means that faith is never alone. It always has its object. And when the object of faith is solus Christus, then no works are needed, for Christ has done it all for you.
Please alone I stand.
Sola gratia, grace alone. We are saved by the grace of God alone. For Luther, salvation was anchored in the eternal, inscrutable purpose of God. Luther anticipated the human-centeredness of piety and guarded against it by insisting that God's grace comes from outside ourselves. Faith is not a human possibility, nor a dimension of the religious personality. It is a radical and free gift of God. This is the reason why our theology is certain, Luther explained. It snatches us away from ourselves and places us outside ourselves, so that we do not depend on our own strength, conscience, experience, person, or works, but depend on that which is outside ourselves, that is, on the promise and truth of God, which cannot deceive. Luther saw the human will enslaved by sin and Satan. We think we are free, he contended, but we only reinforce our bondage by indulging in sin. Grace releases us from this enslaving illusion and leads us into the glorious liberty of the children of God. God wants us to love him freely, but that is only possible when we have been freed from captivity to Satan and self. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all my sin. How shall my tongue describe it? Where shall its praise begin? Excerpts from Ephesians 2 verses 8 to 10 reads, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them."
The glory of God is the holiness of God put on display. That is, it is the infinite worth of God made manifest. So, we may define God's glory as the beauty and greatness of his manifold perfections. We must constantly remind ourselves that we are speaking of a glory that is ultimately beyond any in comparison. This beauty and greatness exists without origin, without comparison, without analogy, without being judged by any external criteria. The glory of God is the goal of all things. The great mission of the Church is to declare God's glory among the nations. Our ultimate hope is to see God's glory. We rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Moreover, we will not only see God's glory, but we will also, in some sense, share in his glory. So I exhort the elders among you, as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. It doesn't seem to end right with our narration of Soli Deo Gloria without mentioning Johann Sebastian Bach, the prolific composer of music for churches and state. In fact, Eisenach is known for being the birthplace of Johann Sebastian Bach. Luther also spent a great deal of time there as a student. In fact, Luther and Bach went to the same school, St. George's Parish School. Bach took the lessons of the Reformation to heart, and he was devoted to his faith. As Bach would bring his musical compositions to a close, whether those were compositions for the church or for state functions, he would end with two sets of initials. On one side would be JSB for his own name, and on the other side would be the initials SDG for Soli Deo Gloria. For all of these beautiful works that came from Bach and created in Eisenach were done for the glory of God.
Thank you. himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel, God with us. And the government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. The birth of this miraculous child was foretold by him in many prophets of old. Imagine the joy and excitement for those who witnessed the event of his birth. For the Magi from the East, these events are so memorable that year after year they still get together to recount what happened on that night long ago.
I remember. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about.
Thank you. Thank you. Christ.